Hello, everybody. Welcome to this last panel of our program, 2 days of cyborgs, freaks, hacktivists. My name is Daniela Silvestrin. I'm part of the Disruption Network Lab team. And I will be moderating this panel today. So we've heard a lot about the history and different moments and aspects of the cyborg during the last 30 years. We went a little bit along the different chapters of Antonio Caronia's book. That is the reason for our 2 days event. And this last panel is dedicated to the last chapter in the book, which this is the title of the last chapter, Postscript from the Cyborg to the Posthuman. And this will be... This will be the topic of today, or this panel. And in this last chapter, Caronia talks about the most recent developments in the notion and understanding and visions related to the concept of the cyborg. And he introduces the terms transhumanism and posthumanism. And I will, before we start to go into the different presentations of today, I will tell you a little bit what these terms stand for so that we can actually start from a common basis of understanding and then go deeper into the historical and critical aspects and details, but also into details of experimental and hands-on approaches related to that. And before I do my little introduction, I wanted to present to you my the speakers of this panel and my guests today. I will present them to you in the order of their presentations. So we will first have Christopher Conan. And he has a background in political and social sciences, history and media ICT studies. He's a senior researcher at the Institute for Technology Assessment and Systems Analysis at the Karlsruhe Institute of Technology. His research focuses on political, philosophical, historical, and public aspects of new and emerging technosciences, such as nanotechnology and synthetic biology, and of the related discourses, such as that of human enhancement. He is the coordinator of the EU-funded large-scale stakeholder and public dialogue project Synenergene on synthetic biology, and also the editor-in-chief of the journal Nanoethics, of which you can see the latest edition of at the cash desk, and have a look. After that, we have Jack Halberstam with us. He gave a great presentation already 2 days ago that many of you might have seen at ICI Berlin. And so probably you know him already quite well, so I will just quickly introduce him. He's a gender and queer theorist and author and professor of American studies and ethnicity. Gender Studies and Comparative Literature at the University of Southern California. He works and researches, writes, blogs, lectures in the areas of popular, visual, and queer culture, and on topics such as queer failure, sex in media, gender variance, monstrosity, or the concept of the wild. Among his most recent publications that you might know are the books The Queer Art of Failure and Gaga Feminism, Sex, Gender, and the End of Normal. So, and then after Jack, we will have Stefan Greiner, that some of you also might know already. He's well known here in Berlin, I guess, or he's a Berlin-based cyborg hacktivist and the co-founder of Cyborgs e.V. He's trained as an electrical engineer and studied human factors in human-computer interaction at TU Berlin. He says he likes hacking his body in order to augment his sensory apparatus, and I read that he is or was able to speak on the phone through his finger. So I'm looking forward to hear more about that later. Besides that, he's also he co-founded the spin-off called New Sense Lab at Humboldt University, where he currently works on health-related big data analysis. So welcome to all my panelists. Thanks so much for being here. I'm really looking forward to your presentations. Before that, as I said, I wanted to quickly introduce the topic of transhumanism. We will hear more about the roots that actually go far more back than we might think in the history, but it became a more well-known concept and term and movement around the end of the 80s or beginning of the 90s. Mainly, one main figure there was Max Mohr, who founded the Extropy Institute in California. And he created this, or he authored the Extropianism Manifesto, and through the Extropy Institute, he organized a series of events and talks and presentations that introduced the whole concept of the transhumanism to a wider audience. And the Extropy Institute doesn't exist anymore, but today it's more, it's all collected under the movement or organization called Humanity Plus, H Plus, that you might have heard of, of which figures such as Ray Kurzweil, also Max Mohr and his wife Natasha Vita Mohr, or also Nick Bostrom, a philosopher teaching at Oxford University, are part of. And the transhumanists understand the transhumanism as a movement in the tradition of humanism and the Enlightenment, but they want to go further than that. So their goal is the transcendence of the human evolution, and they want to take on the role of the natural selector and the driving force behind human evolution. And so it becomes a kind of ultra-humanism, and I think Jack will then talk more about that. So what is transhumanism? The definition that you can find is that it's a class of philosophies that seek continuation and acceleration of the evolution of intelligent life beyond its current human form and human limitations by means of science and technology guided by life-promoting principles and values. And I quote Nick Bostrom, he says, transhumanism views human nature as a work in progress, a half-baked beginning that we can learn to remold in desirable ways. So transhumanism seeks for humanity to eventually manage to become post-human, which are beings that with a vastly greater capacity than present human beings have. So posthumanism here is a term that is maybe what is important to say, that normally or often we know the term from critical theory and critical philosophy, where it intends a posthumanistic and post-anthropocentric way of relating to the world based on decentralized and non-hierarchical modes of thinking. Whereas in transhumanism, it has a different meaning then. So here the term is used to talk about possible future beings whose basic capacities so radically exceed those of present humans as to be no longer unambiguously human by our current standards. So posthumans might shape themselves and their environment in so many new and profound ways that speculations about the detailed features of posthumans and the posthuman world are likely to fail. So they could be completely synthetic artificial intelligences or enhanced uploads or the result of making many smaller but cumulatively profound augmentations to a biological human. And so the term transhuman actually is a shorthand for transitional human, so on the transition on the way to becoming posthuman. So Transhumanism has two main goals or two main steps in an evolution towards the posthuman. The first is human enhancement of the human body to overcome biological limitations. This can be neuroenhancement, cognitive enhancement, pharmacological enhancement, or what I find the most creepy one, moral enhancement. Through things such as surgery, drugs, prosthetics, implants, functional food, technological devices, nanotechnology, gene therapy, genetic engineering, combinations of all those. So it's any attempt to temporarily or permanently overcome the current limitations of the body through natural or artificial means. There are different ways, of course, in which these possible futures of the human are being explored. One is kind of grassroots and DIY approaches and movements that do. They do experiments with body hacks and open source technologies that are applied on or implemented in the body. These are images from Tim Cannon's body experiments that you might have seen. And I guess Stefan will tell us more about his experiences and also from the Cyborg FV and their vision and ideas. And then there are more conceptual explorations of this topic. And here, for example, you have the primo posthuman, the concept developed by Natasha Vita-Moore that I mentioned earlier. And this, she developed this kind of future shopping catalog for an entire body design that has features such as memory enhancement, sonar sensors, solar protected skin with hue texture changeability, gender reconfigurability, environmental friendly waste disposal, and of course it can be upgraded. Finally, another way of exploring and imagining both utopian and dystopian outlooks and possible futures is science fiction literature. And here we come back to Caronia again and his interest or in exploration of that discipline and field, where there are science fiction novels and books such as Greg Egan's Permutation City, Greg Bear, Darwin's Radio, James Patrick Kelly, Mr. Boy, or Jim Monroe, Everyone in Silico. So this was the human enhancement, as I said, is the step or the goal to go towards the second goal, which is to overcome death. So to eventually become immortal. That is the ultimate goal of transhumanists and death, they see death as the ultimate burden of humanity and more a kind of imposed doctrine rather than a natural part of life. And there are now a series of different projects, initiatives, and companies that mainly are located, of course, in California and Silicon Valley, such as Calico, which is an independent research and development biotech company. That was established by Google in 2013, and it has the goal of combating aging and associated diseases. Calico is a shorthand for California Life Company. There's also Sense, which is a research foundation and nonprofit organization that does research on the application of regenerative medicine to aging. And its goal is to transform the way the world researches and treats age-related diseases. Then there's, for example, also the 2045 Initiative, which is a nonprofit organization that develops a network and community of researchers in the field of life extension, whose main goal is to create technologies enabling the transfer of an individual's personality to a more advanced non-biological career and extending life, including to the point of immortality. They devote particular attention to enabling the fullest possible dialogue between the world's major spiritual traditions, science, and society. And last but not least, there's now even an official political party in the US, the Transhumanist Party, whose leader Zoltan Istvan is running for president in 2016. And he said that if you voted me, I would do my best to guarantee you an indefinite lifespan. So now you have all the bases and grounds to enjoy even more the presentations that are about to come, and then later on to reflect and discuss with us the different issues and questions that will pop up. So I give the microphone to Christopher and...
Hello, it's great to be here. And I'm quite happy because many of the things that I thought I would need to say have now been perfectly said by you, so I can quite quickly go to my main topic, namely historical aspects. So, okay, and you also introduced me, thank you. So the KIT is the large one, and the Institute for Technology Assessment and Systems Analysis is the institute within the KIT, and we also have an office here in Berlin, which gives advice to the German parliament. Okay, does it work? Okay. Transhumanism, okay, we now have heard quite a lot of things already, but I really like this quote from the former version of the Transhumanist Declaration. H+ has modified it, has made it much less radical, I would say. I think there's some... Any idea? Okay, nevertheless, go on a bit because we don't want to be too late. So I read a little bit out of this quote. Okay, science will transform the body, that's human enhancement. But as Daniela has already said, the goals of the transhumanists are much larger. So Winward Reed wrote is that with one faith and with one desire, man will labor together in a sacred cause. The extinction of disease and sin, the perfection of genius and love, the invention of immortality, the exploration of the infinite and the conquest of creation. So that's the program. So maybe you can I give you science? Because one, two. It's the same. No, okay. So that was the quote in the next slide. Okay, as you all also. Yeah, that's maybe an idea. Okay, and you also had said a few words and I also add a few others concerning the IT industry's interest in this topic. So discount on singularity being this quasi-religious concept, was for example the motto of the Intel Developer Forum already in 2008. And then there's this picture with Kurzweil and Gates, and then we have Peter Thiel, just Google him, interesting person I think made money with PayPal and early investor in Facebook, and he gives quite a lot of funding to transhumanists. And interestingly also, the Google founders have several times now said that one of their goals is to have Google in the brain, and they believe that we will merge with machines in a few decades. And then there's this discussion about artificial intelligence becoming more intelligent than us, and even maybe as a kind of risk. There's an ongoing discussion on this at the moment. And most of us in our institute, we came to these topics due to a 2001 policy initiative by the US National Science Foundation and the US Department of Commerce, and there were involved many like DARPA and other military research, but also firms and Sherry Turkle, so very good intellectuals too, and the so-called NBIC, Convergent Technology Initiatives, which was massively influenced by transhumanist ideas, and one leading transhumanist was the co-editor of the book. In these years, he did not present himself as a transhumanist too openly, but it became clear afterwards. Okay, and then just very quickly, again, this idea, as you had already said, this is idea of it starts with the beginning of the universe, and it ends that the universe wakes up due to intelligence stemming from humanity, but being post-human. And of course you see cyborgs and androids in all kinds of pop culture. So when I give talk in schools, for example, they are much less surprised as, say, the audience in a church academy or so, because yes, we know this, and yeah, of course you can enhance your character and love in the computer game. So I think these beings are with us, and I would say that I use cyborg now only in the sense of physical merger of humans and machines, so no other conceptual broader things. That's the topic for today. Cyborgization, maybe a few things you do not know. One example are brain-computer interfaces, where signals, where brain activity is used as an input, and this can be used for example, you see the late Matthew Nagel here, and this gave him the opportunity to slowly at least use a computer. But you can also have this just on your skull, and then you, for example, in the Berlin brain-computer interface, they made a number of experiments, and also this one playing pinball without hands. And then, of course, there's some discussion, although something like the cheetah legs of Amy Mullins on the upper right, which also Oscar Pistorius uses, they are, of course, purely mechanical, but they will most probably very soon be quite efficient limb procedures with neural electric interfaces. And so this is also a kind of bodily cyborgization to some extent. On the left, down left is Yuher, and he lost as an 18 or 17-year-old man, lost while climbing due to the cold, lost his lower legs, and he's now a very good engineer at MIT. In terms of human enhancement, of course, he can already do some of, and we could also, if we would use it, some of them are built in a way that everyone can use it. We can, of course, already do with these prostheses more than some of the things that we can do with natural legs. And the development goes in the direction to make them in a way that it feels like your own limbs and has sensations. And you can, of course, have all kind of extra skills, so to say, in them. Okay, then here are some cyborgs. Some of them, like the veterans, I would say, Kevin Warwick, the researcher, and Stellark, which already did this, I think, early 90s or so, as far as I remember. Absolutely brilliant performances, by the way, Stellark. And there are some others, like Tim Cannon and Opak, but maybe you will say a few more words on this. Okay, and then she exaggerates some points too, but I would like to draw your attention to this work. I don't know how to pronounce her, basically, Asen Murray, probably the Enlightenment cyborg. And she argues that we, in our discussions today, we are maybe a little bit too fascinated by the new. So we should take into account that in this real large body of literature during the Enlightenment, it really forbids to say something like the Enlightenment was based on the Cartesian subject and the cyborg breaks with this. This is most often not true, because in Enlightenment literature was so diverse. And this is just one example that if you really want to take serious the historic perspective, we must look a little bit closer. And I will look at a very specific thing, namely the prehistory of cyborgs in the sense of the early transhumanism between 1870 and 1930. And I discussed this against the background of what can be maybe called the sublime of life. And that's the idea that already the grandfather of Charles Darwin, Erasmus Darwin, he already had this idea of solidarity. We are life, like with all the other animals, and we realize how long it took that life developed something like us. And so this is a kind of glorification of life. And in Shelley, you have this nicely formulated, what are changes of empires, the wreck of dynasties with the opinions which supported them, what is the birth and extinction of religious and political systems to life, What are the revolutions of the globe which inhabit and the operations of the animals, elements of which it is imposed compared with life? What is the universe of stars and suns and their motions and their destiny compared with life? And this kind of glorification of life is on the basis of the early transhumanism. And to my knowledge, the first real transhumanist, as I would define transhumanism on the basis of these quotes in the beginning, was Winwood Reed, an Africa explorer. He wanted to first become a writer, and then he was an Africa explorer, and also corresponded with Charles Darwin. And after one of his trips to Africa, he wrote a book called The Martyrdom of Man, and probably feverishly at the West African coast. And it influenced quite a few people, and Cecil Rhodes, the imperialist, Winston Churchill as a young man, and I'm not so knowledgeable about Victorian masculinities, but I think what is important is that at this stage, as I understood from very few literature that I read, is there is this tendency that some of the imperialist men, so to say, go to countries not with the Bible and the gun anymore, and they are muscular, but not necessarily muscular Christianity. But he became, after reading this book, Churchill, extremely, because he loved science and found science so important, extremely atheistic and anti-Christian. And this guy, Winwood Reed, posthumously became a real hero for the freethinker movement, and this little essay was printed in large numbers until the 1930s or so. And other readers were, Wells was absolutely fascinated, H.G. Wells, George Orwell, many others. Okay, again here, this long perspective. I think this is when we think about the transhumanist cyborg, so to say. As you said, there's always this long perspective. So it's not just about new skills and enhancement, but it's, for many of them, it's a kind of a worldview, or in Germany, a Weltanschauung, which includes the future. And here Reed addresses the post-human beings of the future, saying that you blessed ones who shall inherit the future age of which we can only dream. Again, this point that, like in religion, we cannot imagine how beautiful paradise will be. You pure and radiant beings who shall succeed us on the earth, when you turn back your eyes on us poor savages, grubbing in the ground for our daily bread, eating flesh and blood, dwelling in vile bodies which degrade us every day to a level with the beast, tortured by pains and by animal propensities, buried in gloomy superstitions, ignorant of nature, which yet hold us in her bonds. When you read us in books, of us in books, when you think of what we are and compare us with yourselves, remember that it is to us you owe the foundation of your happiness and grandeur. So the idea that we are just, it's our mission to help realize this grandiose future. And we can do this in our libraries and laboratories, star towers, and dissecting rooms and workshops. And H.G. Wells, who is probably he's definitely the most famous of these early transhumanists, I would say. Even Julian Huxley, H.G. Wells, I think, is well known as a science fiction author. And here again, we have this. And look at this play with body and mind in the following what I say, because this being on top of on the left, top left, is an illustration of, I think, one of the Martians. But many of these creatures that you encounter in some of the stories of Wells, they have all this idea that with the progress of evolution, so to say, it's a strange concept, but that's the way that they thought about it. The brain would be larger and larger and larger. And so the higher castes of these future races, which are a little bit spooky, all of them, they have massive brains and are often brought by the slave castes because they cannot even walk anymore, because this is all unnecessary energy, so we just need the brain. And again, you have this kind of appeal to the sublime of life. And I don't want to say too much about it, but maybe it's probably a little bit small, so I'll read a little bit of it. We look back through countless millions of years, these long perspectives, thanks to evolutionary thinking, thanks to geology, thanks to modern physics. There were these they now knew some 200 years ago, many people still thought that the world is a couple of thousand years old, and then things changed in these times. And there's again the idea that he talks about all these beings in the intertidal slime and afterwards, and it sounds like as they are us to some extent. So of course we are the crowning moment, but it goes on, and that's the important thing. So the old many utopian schemes and some of the ideas in Enlightenment was always that the human being is the crown, almost like in Christianity is like the highlight and the culmination of this process. And he says, this fact that man is not final is the great unmanageable disturbing fact that rises upon us in the scientific discovery of the future. And to my mind, at any rate, the question what is to come after man is the most persistently fascinating, the most insoluble question in the whole world. And then at the very end, there is one quote which still often pops up in all kinds, even in policy reports. And the entire text, by the way, was published in Nature and after 8 years later in New York Times and was much discussed in these times in, between 1900 and 1910. And he writes at the end, all this world is heavy with the promise of greater things, and a day will come, one day in the unending succession of days, when beings who are now latent in our thoughts and hidden in our loins, so it's biologically, it's still the idea, it's a biological post-human, which is still, will stand upon this earth as one stands on a footstool and laugh and reach out the hand amidst the star, and again the idea, conquer the universe. The footstool thing is a Christian one. I will not talk about this, but it's one of the many biblical and religious images these early transhumanists use. So here you see Jesus with one naked foot on the planet. And what is important, I think, is that in early transhumanism, and this is more a political thing, like we now talked about Wells, who was already kind of socialist, but the most important figure in developing really modern transhumanism is John Desmond Burnell, and he was a communist and a very good scientist. And the same is true for Haldane, who still thought biologically, but this kind of cyborgization of the transhumanist dream is done by Burnell. And what takes place there is an othering of the non-scientific mind, which is of course quite a usual thing, but you must keep in mind that at these times the scientists, and in particularly applied sciences and the engineers, had not the same status as today. So they had to struggle with an elite which is thought that the most important thing to learn are Greek poems and these kind of things. And so, and I think this in an excellent essay in 1941, Orwell, who was of course like everyone, he said everyone who was young, who was of my age, when he or she was young, adored Wells, and Wells had the, so to say, was the synonym for the future, but at these times he was not happy with his visions anymore. And so he writes, he belongs to the non-military, okay, this is a positive description, and he belongs to the non-military middle class, and the thunder of guns and all this militarism leaves him manifestly cold. And he hates fighting, hunting, the fighting, hunting, swashbuckling side of life. And then he, there is this kind of juxtaposition of men of science, composition of men of science who is working towards a planned world state. That's his utopia, and all these kind of reactionary forces who try to restore a disorderly past. And basically, I think Orwell quite precisely says that for Wells, history is a series of victories won by the scientific man over the romantic man. And you can, if you like, watch this film, Things to Come, from 1936. The guy on the top is in the film styled after Burnell, and the story is in a post-catastrophic London, which is ruled by a feudalistic pity ruler, which is brilliantly played in a way that he really resembles very much Mussolini, so in all the way that he moves. And he comes from Basra, Iraq, and they built this new world state, and of course it ends with a vision of going to outer space, and again this story. It's very nice because this cyborg, so to say, no, he's not a cyborg, he's just a scientist, extremely arrogant and with a high-tech armor and comes to this, and there the others, they're still riding horses and so. It's an interesting movie. Okay, and this is at the core, I would say, of the transhumanist vision is this, again, a religious metaphor, this essay, The World, the Flesh, and the Devil, an inquiry into the future of the three enemies of the rational soul. And this man, Bunnell, was quite an interesting guy. And like Haldane and Bunnell, they were also culturally, I would say, quite progressive and led a kind of a little bit scandalous life. At the same time, he was a very brilliant scientist. So on the left of this youthful portrait, you see Watson and Crick, who wanted to be in his lab, but he rejected. I think one of them showed a model. And on the right side, you see, under Soviet Britain, you see a picture which is now at the entrance hall of the Wellcome Trust, which a drunken Picasso painted on his wall when they were met for some communist meeting in the 1950s. And basically, he says quite simply, sooner or later, some eminent physiologist will have his neck broken in a super civilized accident or find his body cells worn beyond capacity for repair, means grown old. He will then be forced to decide whether to abandon his body or his life. After all, it is brain that counts, and to have a brain suffused by fresh and correctly prescribed blood is to be alive, to think. So it's a scientist religion or quasi-religion, quite obviously. And then there is this grandiose vision of it starts with a brain, and this is then connected to all kinds of machinery, and in the end, we have the perfect cyborg, but all these brains are interconnected with each other, so this is the Moravets and Minsky things, who are not referring to him, while the Christian guy, the Frank Tipler, who has the same ideas, at least refers to him, because this is just stolen, I would say. This is just plagiarism, Moravets, Minsky, and a lot of Kurzweil, by the way, I would say, because it's exactly the same ideas. And like in Kurzweil, in the end, bit by bit, the heritage of the direct line of mankind, the heritage of the original life emerging on the face of the world would dwindle and in the end disappear effectively, being preserved perhaps as some curious relic. And humans, by the way, for quite some time will be natural humans, utopians, will have a utopian life on Earth, secretly controlled in a kind of human zoo from an extraterrestrial techno-scientific elite. That's also something I think sounds very much like the Sloterdijk idea. And finally, consciousness itself may end or vanish in a humanity that has become completely etherealized, looting the close-knit organism, becoming masses of atoms in space, communicating by radiation, and ultimately perhaps resolving itself entirely into light. That may be an end or a beginning, but from here it's out of sight. And that's very religious. He was very religious in his youth, a fanatic Jesuit and Irish nationalist, and then almost a strong believer in communism, only at the very end. Okay, I'm good in time. So another thing, originally my idea was, because I thought I would just talk 5 or 10 minutes and we had a lot of discussion, I just wanted to show some pictures and give some anecdotes. It was not only these people in these years who thought about these things. And maybe you have seen this, John Gray, this quite polemic British philosopher, has written a book, The Immortalization Commission. And in a nice article he wrote, Are Sergey Brin and Mark Zuckerberg God Builders? And he refers here to the interest of current IT billionaires in transhumanist visions that we have already talked about, and to cosmism in Tsarist Russia and to its legacy in the early Soviet Union. And Gray writes, and as far as I can see from other literature, this is all more or less correct. I say what I think is not true. The Soviet trade minister Leonid Krasin and the education minister Anatoly Lunacharsky were leading figures in the Immortalization Commission, the body set up to organize Lenin's funeral. He says, I haven't checked this yet, that they even discussed among the Bolshevik leadership if they should try out some of the, in these time discussed measures to revive humans in order to resurrect Lenin. They did not this, according to Gray, but they were influenced, God builders, God builders is cosmism. They were cosmisms, and there were others interesting cosmists, for example, Cholskovsky, who was a pioneer, or I say the man who imagined and conceptualized Soviet astronautics. And this all was based originally on a Russian Orthodox mystic who basically lived in a library, Fedorov, who had exactly these ideas of Tipler, Minsky, and all the others. He believed that in the future, thanks to science and technology, we will be immortal, we will colonize the universe, control the universe, and we can even resurrect technically, with technical means, all that of the past. So we realize the Christian promises by ourselves, by means of science and technology, and in his case, so to say, at the will of God. So God wants us to do this. In other cases, it becomes atheist. Of course, there are many discussions, and you must be a little bit cautious because there are some very wild theory, but also very decent conspiracy theories, but also decent scholarly research. A liberal transhumanist who is also a member of the Italian parliament, I think the only member of the parliament who is a confessed transhumanist, he talks about magical communism. Some religious critics call it left-wing Gnostic Satanism. I haven't been there, but I really would like to see this this monument. Okay, and I will skip my philosophical thing at the end, okay? And maybe you should also have a look at, unfortunately, there's most of it is in Russian or in German, interestingly, because there's a good book on it. The only openly anarchist circle that was not destroyed when the Bolsheviks crushed the anarchists had been the biocosmists. And they said, no, Fedorov is much too religious, and we want even more. And they had the principles of immortalism and interplanetarism. And this was even before Haldane and Burnell, so early 20s, end of the 1910s. And Trotsky, because I understood that Trotsky is, so to say, with us to some extent in this context, he polemicized against cosmism, and in particular the cosmist influence on such different, very important movements in the Soviet Union concerning work, the organization of work, and so on. But he also wrote that the human race will not have ceased to crawl on all fours before God, kings, and capital in order later to submit humbly before the dark laws of heredity and a blind sexual salation. And maybe we can create a superman, and a man will become immeasurably stronger, wiser, and subtler, and the average human type will rise to the heights of an Aristotle, a Goethe, or Marx. Okay, I skipped this one because basically he's a great scientist and communist activist. In the end of his life, he became a whole day and a little bit frustrated with the communist movement and their hatred for modern genetics, and so he went to India. And as my last thing, what I would also like to point out, in particular in this context, is that that's the immediate anti-transhumanist cultural backlash that took place in the 1920s and early 1930s is even more influential, I would say, culturally than, okay, not in technoscience. In technoscience, transhumanism is more influenced, but in broader culture, the anti-transhumanist cultural backlash is much more influential, I would say, because there's this brave new world, which is still read, I think, in many states in the US as a kind of mandatory literature, was quoted by Bush in his first, W. Bush in his first press conference. And this is clearly, they knew each other very well, these people, and there were even some family members, like you will say now in a minute, was about Julian Huxley, the brother. And so they knew each other very well, and they described, on the one hand, they criticized this, they wrote dystopian visions, which portrayed the kind of negative sides of transhumanism, and they also were involved in myth-making, like Tolkien and C.S. Lewis. So C.S. Lewis, he wrote science fiction in where he really styled the evil scientists which tried to conquer the universe after Haldane and Burnell. And finally, Tolkien, which is, I think, now the most influential one due to The Lord of the Rings. If you look at this closely and also look at the letters, in particular letter she wrote to the brilliant writer Naomi Mitchison, which is, by the way, again, the sister of Haldane. If you look at this, you can see that this Lord of the Rings story is basically this one ring of Sauron is technoscience, and these creepy monsters, the Nazgul, are humans which are turned undead by this means of technoscience and are incredibly frightening and incredibly desperate themselves. And so that's a kind of very negative and very influential anti-transhumanist mythmaking. And I skipped the philosophy and leave you with this. Many thanks for your attention.
All right. Thank you to Daniela for organizing such an interesting panel and for inviting me to be on it. And thank you for that presentation, which I'll probably refer to a little bit as I go. It was really great, actually, to get the history of transhumanism and to see, you know, this first book from, what was it, 1857 or 72, Winwood Reed, you know, it sort of tells you almost everything you need to know about transhumanism, that the first proponent of transhumanism is obviously a colonialist who's writing a book called Savage Africa, and who has a vision in mind of, you know, the extended survival of a certain kind of human. And I don't think we have to guess too long and too hard to figure out what humans will survive and what humans will be consigned to the category of death and living death. So I'm going to try to pull forward some of my deep concerns about transhumanism while pointing to bodies of work, both aesthetic and theoretical, that are trying to think through the relations between life, death, and living death in this era of, you know, what seems like exponential technological leaps. I mean, that's the kind of claim that this guy Ray Kurzweil makes, so I just want to give you a sense. You've heard a couple of times what he espouses, and he's somebody who writes books that are on the New York Times bestsellers, so he's not just a kook, you know, he's not a Unabomber holed up somewhere writing little missives to himself, but in a way he might as well be, because this is really crazy stuff. And the idea is that in no other period of human history have we made such technological leaps so quickly and with such an impact on life as we know it. And for that reason, if the logic holds and we continue to make these technological leaps, then we are just years away from being able to revive human bodies. So given that we now can, you know, map the genome, we have cures for diseases we never thought would be cured, we have all kinds of technological enhancements we never imagined, you know, the argument goes, if this continues, the graph continues up, then we'll eventually reach that moment where, when you're dying of something, instead of getting a bone marrow transplant, you get a new infusion of cells. All of your cells will be remade, and you will live forever. And now, this fantasy of immortal life is the one that I want to take issue with. And I want to, weirdly, maybe, make an argument for death. Okay? Because one of the fantasies of the cyborg, of course, is the permanence of the human, that the human takes a form that is no longer subject to the decay, the propensity to decay that marks the material body, that within the context of the cyborg, that life can go on. But we don't live in a value-free world, and so whenever these fantasies emerge, there are always fantasies about one group or one class of people whose survival will be ensured, but only in one of these neoliberal bargains within which the survival of these people will be paid for by either the death or the consignment to living death of the multitudes. And even though that seems obvious, there's a way in which these very ecstatic, enthusiastic conversations about cyborgs don't take that into consideration nearly enough. And so, so that's what I want to talk about today. And I have a couple of different examples I'm going to give you of this ecstatic transhumanism and the social form that it takes and the way in which it's already with, you know, here, and what interventions have been made without necessarily calling themselves transhumanism on behalf of transhumanism. I'm also going to be arguing against something that I did talk about at the ICI the other day called zombie humanism. And zombie humanism is the production of enhanced life opportunities for the few through the bargain that consigns the many to living death. And I gave many, many examples, but, you know, poverty, imprisonment, starvation, disease, these are the kinds of ways in which first world peoples often make bargains within which they're happy to have their lives enhanced, not recognizing the calculus within which other lives are wasted. So I also want to talk a little bit then about this early transhumanism, and we heard one trajectory, and I'm not going to go into it in too much detail, but in its early 20th century forms, I think you can see the way in which transhumanism has a kind of fascist element to it, and this is important for us to think about and talk about. So early transhumanism was used very clearly by somebody like Julian Huxley, who we could say was an early eugenic thinker, and I'm going to talk about new versions of eugenics now. It is true, he was the brother of Aldous Huxley, and Brave New World may well be either a critique of transhumanism, or you could even read it as also the narration of transhumanism. But Julian Huxley was less fanciful than his brother, and he concentrated supposedly on science and not on science fiction. But his idea was that there are some forms of life, some races, who are degraded, and therefore it wouldn't matter if you wasted their life potential, because what you take from their, you know, the way in which if we limit their use of resources in the world, then we can enhance the life opportunities of superior beings. So that was he's credited with using this term transhumanism early on, and prior to World War II, that was kind of his take. He's like, hey, there are people who should be able to live as long as possible, and there are other people who really don't matter. Now, post-World War II, of course, this would not at all be a reasonable position. And so he then backed off a little bit and said that the real thing is to make shifts in the social environment. But it's very clear in his thinking that there's a sort of fascist project at work. So like the guy who first writes Savage Africa as his transhumanist manifesto, so Julian Huxley produces a kind of fascist transhumanism. Okay, so my idea of zombie humanism can be pitted against this transhumanism. Now, in zombie humanism, I guess I'm just using it as a term to try to explain how humanism is working right now and why we're so obsessed with zombies at this particular moment and how it is that we recognize that we actually do live with all these classifications of people who are living dead. You know, the very old in retirement homes, the very sick, the very young who have no rights, the very poor who have no options, right? The people who are living in vegetative states. And what I want to make an argument is about the way in which we are using the term life. Life for whom? At what cost? In what measures? Using up what resources? We're living at a time when obviously we are in deep environmental crisis, and it seems ironic and wrong to me that we are spending so much of our time in terms of our technological imagination, trying to figure out how to extend life, extending the life of the people who have put the planet in danger in the first place. So one of the precepts of zombie humanism is that the very ideas and populations who have endangered the world in the first place cannot now be its saviors. That, if you like, is my main point, that there's a kind of colonial project right now within humanism whereby you see all of these former colonial powers arguing for that we should, you know, we have to save the earth. But there's never a sort of consultation with formerly colonized nations or philosophies. There's just this sense that, not that we have endangered it and we must now fix it, but we who are living at a moment of great danger must be the heroic humans who now save us. And I'll give you some examples of that as we go. Okay, I'm going to give you two examples of transhumanist projects that I think show the implications of transhumanism as I've laid them out, as being sort of crypto-fascist, if you like. So the first one is the de-extinction movement. Do you guys know about the de-extinction movement? Yeah. This sounds like one of those great Save the Earth movements that I'm talking about, where former colonial powers are saying, oh, we need to do something, let's gather together and save the Earth. So the de-extinction movement was created by Stuart Brand, who is the author of the Whole Earth Catalog. So he's this sort of right-on environmentalist, and this idea is very transhumanist. He says, we now have the technology to bring extinct creatures back from the dead. Okay? Not how did they become extinct, why are they extinct, why are more species going extinct than ever before, what are the environmental conditions under which extinction is such a massive problem or has exponentially increased. No, that's not the project. The project is find a creature, your favorite creature that recently went extinct, scrape a little DNA out of whatever place you found it in the ground, the fossil that you have, and recreate your favorite lost creature, and as he puts it, pop it back in the wild. Okay. Pop it back in the wild, kind of tells you everything that you need to know, this fantasy that there's a wild, that the missing creatures can just be restored to their environment, as if it's not the fact that their environment has been wasted in the first place, which is why they're extinct. So we create these circular kinds of arguments within which people are set up to heroically restore what has been wasted, and no responsibility for the wasting is actually given. All right, so, and I'll just give you a few more slides. So it's called the Revive and Restore Project of bringing extinct species back to life using genomic technology. And here's the transhumanist rhetoric. Genomic technology and techniques are advancing rapidly. It's becoming feasible to reconstitute the genomes of vanished species in living forms. And so then we can have an ecological enrichment through extinct species revival. Revive and restore, you know, get your T-shirt, get your tote bag. And let's create this cornucopia and put these creatures back in the wild. Okay, here's what the movement actually says. And the Brand's organization is called the Long Now Foundation. Endangered species that have lost their crucial genetic diversity. Notice that no one is responsible for this. Species have just lost. This is like something out of Monty Python, right? Where did my crucial genetic diversity go? I don't know. I lost it. I became extinct. And still in the passive voice, we've lost this crucial thing, but it may be restored, and then we will, again, have reproductive health. Oh, good. Okay, excellent. Those threatened by invasive diseases may be able to acquire genetic disease resistance. It may even be possible to bring some extinct species back to life. Blah, blah, blah. The ultimate aim is to restore them to their former home in the wild, right? So, and remember, the wild was lost with old Windwood, or whatever his name was, trudging into savage Africa, right, and creating complete and utter desolation across the continent under the heading of colonialism. So what we need is a post-colonial or a decolonial critique of environmental collapse that looks back at the causes of environmental collapse, not these cyborgian fantasies of a future in which we can redeem what has been lost, okay? So that's the version of humanism that I'm arguing for the death of on behalf of a much more mitigated and accountable understanding of the human. How many? 10? Okay, great, thank you. The other thing to say about that is that all of this is in Ice Age. You could just watch Ice Age. That's what I did. But the other thing to note is that there's a lot of Christian rhetoric revive and restore. This is a Christian rhetoric of resurrecting lost species. And that Christian rhetoric that always promised you that there is life after death is what I believe is also fueling this fantasy of eternal life. We seem to be forgetting that Christ had to die before he came back. There's just a sense of missing that piece and this extended life, but an extended life that I do believe is part of a Christian mythos. Okay, another version of this The second transhumanist project that we're all sort of subject to and in relationship to is what I call extreme reproduction. So at a moment of absolutely intense overpopulation in the world, but also in Europe and the US, at a moment of decreasing white birth demographics, right? You know, white birth rates are declining, so-called immigrant birth rates are increasing. At this particular moment, we have huge efforts under the heading of technology to enhance life opportunity being directed at increasing the reproductive chances of white bourgeois people. This is, to me, you know, almost unethical, again, that we spend massive amounts of money to make sure that certain people can pass on their biology to the next generation despite the fact that their bodies are not willing, right? Why do we need to give 52-year-old women the opportunity to pass on their biological code to another generation? The egg freezing, sperm banks, this is my apocalypse slide, never mind. Egg donation, sperm donation, a lot of these are very, very expensive technologies, and they are transhumanist technologies, and they are about extending white life at any cost. At the same moment that we've become very aware of the fact that black life is often rendered disposable, which is why you have to have these movements within the US that say black lives matter. Why do you have to tell people that black lives matter? I mean, it would be nonsensical to say white lives matter. White lives not only matter, they must be reproduced at all costs. So in the grips of a racial panic around the decline of white people that is intensifying this transhumanist project around extreme reproduction. Okay, and that's Mr. Kurzweil, think big. To say that while transhumanists imagine themselves into a future of immortality, a time when human invention has created the conditions for human regeneration, the important point is that such technology, whether or not it's invented, is neither desirable nor ethical. It simply enacts the very relationship to life and death that has already taken place under neoliberalism, namely enhanced opportunities for life for the few at the expense of decreased opportunities for life of the many. Now, against that kind of transhumanism, I want to just remind you of a strand of autodestructive art that has been an avant-garde practice since the 1960s, and was really a feature of post-war Europe, where lots of different artists engaged in public, very spectacular self-dismantling on behalf of sort of pointing to the void at the center of myths and philosophies of the human, to sort of point to the absolute, I guess, the con game of Enlightenment philosophy. People like Gustav Metzger, the Viennese actionists, the Valley export, people like that, performed very violent self-dismantlings. And I think we're at a moment where we should bring back autodestructive art in order to rethink our relationship to death in more positive ways, if you like, to remind ourselves that we die and that dying is part of being human, not just that the purpose of human life should be to extend endlessly into the future, selfishly into the future, wasting the life opportunities of generations to come in the process. And here's just a really quick survey, and then I'll give you two queer autodestructive artists in conclusion. Gustav Metzger was a Jewish refugee from Germany on the Kindertransport who ended up in England, and instead of making art about how amazing it was that he had survived, he made art about the absolute void at the center of human existence that he felt he had witnessed. So he created artwork that destroyed immediately upon being made, such that you could be in constant relationship, if you like, to mortality and to the secular nature of life. And so he would put up a canvas and burn it with acid. Or he recently sat in a room thinking nothing, and those thoughts were electromagnetically transferred to a drill that created a sculpture of a hole, a complete null void. He's sort of related to, well, he's considered to be the father of punk rock in a way, because Pete Townshend was very influenced by Gustav Metzger's ideas and therefore smashed his instruments on the stage so that this smashing of the instrument became one of the signatures of punk in the 1970s, and you can put punk in the heart of autodestructive art. It's also very related to a strand of queer theory authored by people like Lee Edelman in a kind of apolitical way, but also spoken to by queer of color critics who talk about the calculus of life and death in relationship to race and class, the no future. And then there was this crazy guy, I don't know if you guys remember him from the 60s, this Dutch guy, Bastiaan Adler, who would literally practice falling. He did all of these falls. Now, the important thing is that these were not the Eve Klein falls, the heroic leap into the void that is so spectacular and beautiful, and of course was a sleight of hand. It was created by the camera. He literally filmed himself falling off roofs, driving his bicycle into hedges in one kind of chilling performance that looks a lot like an American lynching. He hangs from a tree until he can hang on no more and falls into a canal. And these would have not been, these were sort of interesting, quiet little moments of autodestructive art, except that then he set off to sail across the Atlantic in a 12-foot boat. I think it was in 1963, maybe. And his boat was found 6 months later off the coast of Ireland. So his last performance was his own death. Rafael Montañez Ortiz, who was a Latino thinker and artist, and also the founder of El Museo del Barrio, the 1966 symposium on autodestructive art began a career-long practice of smashing pianos, and he would often make a big deal about buying the piano first and then smashing it. Or he, at this symposium, bought a chair that a white guy was sitting on. He bought the chair out from under the white guy and then smashed it, sort of playing out these post-colonial fantasies of dispossession, the dispossession of Western civilization, Western music, the piano being this sort of centerpiece of Western harmony. There's I don't need to tell people about the Viennese actionists who were quite interesting in smearing shit and piss on their bodies, but also went in directions, some of which were really fascist and weird, and therefore were critiqued. This is, what's his name, Gunter Bruce, doing one of these famous walkabouts that I really like for the sort of the zombieism of this walkabout around Vienna, calling attention to the continued fascism in post-war Vienna. And then he always had this black line sort of canceling himself out. Valley Export critiqued the masculinism and the sort of barely submerged heroism of the male performers in her very quiet performance, Remote Remote, where she literally cuts her cuticles off and dips her hands in and out of milk while sitting in front of pictures of two sexually abused children. So what all of this work is doing is calling attention to the fact that extending human life is not the point. Creating an environment in which human life is meaningful in a way that goes beyond a few people should be the project. So we would have to be arguing for a transhumanism that was about enhanced life opportunities for as many people as possible, not agreeing to the calculations that transhumanist theorists make, within which technological progress at any cost is to be desired. The queer artists that I wanted to talk about, and I'll just do this, well, I think that this is just to say that the theorist who comes to mind here is Beatrice Preciado, or Paul Preciado's work. It's Paul Preciado, in a way, who has called our attention to the shifting nature of human identity that is no longer simply about embodiment in relationship to prescribed social positions, but is about the molecular and the rearrangement of the molecular through pharmaceutical intervention. And her book is also Testo Junkie, is a sort of cautionary tale about getting too invested in the ecstatic and exciting cycles of human reinvention, and remembering that there are always these undersides to those cycles that include a sort of depression and collapse. The there's just a quote. The two artists that I want to mention by way of conclusion, Heather Castles, who has a show up in a solo show right now in Holland. Heather Castles has a show called Becoming an Image. And Castles is a gender ambiguous person who has built her body up, not to become a new man, a new sort of masculine heroic, but literally to then interact in a self-destructive way with clay. And so she performs this jump in the dark, where in a completely dark room that's only, you can only see what she's doing because a camera keeps flashing on and off, you see her destroying a piece of clay, even as the clay destroys her. And so the question is, what is our relationship between the material that 100 years ago we were so sure that we crafted that material, not that it crafted us? And this is a sort of new materialist reminder that the world and its various vibrant materialities shape us as much as we shape it. She has a new work that is about setting herself on fire, calling to mind the tradition of all kinds of political protests, where often minority subjects have literally set themselves alight to protest wasteful war. I'll show this by way of conclusion. Boy Child, who I believe performs a lot in Berlin, is an artist who often performs very almost tragic Butoh-like performances. And you'll remember Butoh was a sort of grotesque dance performance in the post-Hiroshima period in Japan to call attention to the decaying environment. Boy Child performs these kinds of very slow, grotesque, almost apocalyptic performances to remind us that the world is over. Far from fantasies of transhumanism, and I'll just play this while I speak. Far from fantasies of transhumanism, we're actually living at a moment when it is easier for us to think about the coming end of the world than to think in any way about enhanced futures. So I will stop there. Thank you.
Yeah, hello. So my name is Stefan. I'm not going to talk about so much about transhumanism and life extending measures because I can't tell from my own practice. I haven't experienced any life extension technologies, but I have experienced some more perception-based extensions that I tried myself. So I want to talk about the sensual cyborg and more specifically about body hacking. So hacking the human body in order to augment the human perception by the help of technology. So as always, if you experiment with this kind of stuff, it's always nicer not you alone in the cellar room, in the cellar lab, trying things out, but making it together with people, sharing experiences and sharing knowledge on this kind of stuff. So we founded an association. In German, it's called Verein, called the Cyborgs e.V. So this is a group of amazing people with a different backgrounds, some from more philosophy, hard and software development, even politics. And we just meet regularly and exchange ideas on how this kind of like human technology future should be from our point of view, and try things out on our own bodies. So, you can actually see at the picture here, the antennas are tuned to good vibes, so we see not only a dystopian future of human technology symbiosis, but we think if we have if we create new ideas on how this future will be look like, we can actually have a much more liberating, enriching form of life with the human and technology future. So I will come back to the Cyborgs e.V. and the goals and aims of this group at the end of my talk. First, I want to examine what's actually behind body hacking And what does it mean? So, and what do body hackers actually do? So basically, these are two words, body and hacking. And the human body, of course, it has many functions, but I wanna go more on three main functions that are interesting, especially for the hacking part. These are like that we use our body to feel with our bodies, to communicate with our bodies, and also to move and act with our bodies in our environment. So our bodies are a fundamental sensation and communication medium. The hacking part, on the other hand, is well, you would know like hacking from software hacking, like hackers go into alien systems and hack that. But it's more broadly said a way to bringing something out of its original context and meaning into a different setting. So this is basically done by making new sense, by changing the rules and configuration of the original system and putting that into something different and making something new out of it. Thus, body hacking is all about modifying the sensual communication medium, our bodies. It's about hacking our inner life, the perception, and the way we communicate. So having said this, I think it's important to have a rudimentary understanding of how the information process of our bodies actually work. So I just want to go more onto that now. For example, tip on my fingertip, of course I have the biological receptor here that basically sends an electrochemical signal that goes down to my arm, to my spinal cord, and gives this kind of like pulsed information, electrochemical pulsed information to my brain. So my brain can basically decode, okay, he's tipping on the finger and I can actually feel it. The same for communication. I'm actually able to speak to you because, well, some muscles in my mouth, my tongue, et cetera, are actually activating the ear. I produce sound waves, or better said, the speakers, and the physical sound waves reaching your ears, reaching your inner ears, and what happens there, same thing, your inner ear transforms like the physical sound waves into an electrochemical signal, a pulsed electrochemical signal that your brain can actually decode. So I could go on like that with also, you can perceive my movements, of course, my gestures by the reflection of my body that stands out, reaching this time your eyes, your retina. So what's happened in the retina? It's a similar thing. Your retina is actually transforming this physical waves and energetic forms into an electrochemical signal that goes to the brain. So what actually happens in the brain is just like different patterns from all kinds of biological receptors reaching the brain, and the brain has to find a way to decode this information in order to make sense for us, to actually feel something, and to identify with. So, in the end, since we're little, we are used to this kind of information flow that our body gives to us, and we take it as a whole. So, an information flow that comes from the receptors we have in our bodies, it actually creates this kind of human frame we constantly live through, and we don't question because we are used to our eyes, to our legs, to any kind of receptors, and we don't question this kind of perception we have all the day long. So not only we as humans, we have this kind of like, let's say, ego tunnel, this kind of frame we take for a whole, but also other animals, for example, a bat. There's a nice paper written by Thomas Nagel, What It Is Like to Be a Bat. And I want to question you, would you think you would know what it is like to be a bat? I think, first of all, I would assume that we all believe that bats have experiences just as we humans do. But after all, they are mammals, but represent a range of activity and sensory apparatus that is very different from ours. If you have spent some time in an enclosed space with an excited bat, you know that this is a completely alien form of life, and it's really weird to stay with this kind of animal. But I would argue, since it is also a conscious living being, it also creates this kind of frame for itself. So the bat has also this kind of like way of experiencing the world and creating its own bat's frame, let's say. So let's make an experiment. Try to get from your human frame into this kind of bat frame. Is that possible? Try to imagine like the webbings on your arms, which enables you to fly around at dusk and dawn, like catching some insects in the night. Imagine also having very poor vision and perceiving the surrounding world like by a system of reflected high-frequency sound signals. And imagine like spending your day hanging upside down by your feet in an attic. Well, the last one I'm pretty sure you can imagine very well, but that only tells you what it would be like for you to behave as a bat behaves. And that was actually not a question. So the question was, I want to know what it's like for a bat to be a bat. And I think that makes very clear that we as humans and also other creatures and beings, we constantly live and we are restricted by this kind of frame of our own mind. So, and this frame of our own mind is completely inadequate to the task to, for example, if I ask what is it like to be a bat? So what would help would be kind of a body exchange. If you really would experience the bat's experience for a day, for example, then you could really say, okay, I have felt it and I know what I'm talking about. So this kind of like metamorphosis. And body hacking goes this way. So it's all about like crossing our human frame, let's say our human perception with other frames, right? So to really experience the other. This, I would argue, is the only way to really develop a new understanding for the environment and what, in general, what surrounds us. One example for that is, I don't know if you know or if you have heard about Coco, the lowland gorilla. This is really, I actually just saw it. There's an exhibition right now at the Haus der Kultur in der Welt about ape culture. And I got really flashed when I saw that, because at the picture here you can see Coco, the gorilla, the talking gorilla, with Penny Patterson. And Penny Patterson is Coco's teacher. And what she did is she taught Coco to what she calls learn a gorilla sign language, right? So Coco is basically able to speak more than 1,000 signs, 1,000 words, let's say, and thus is able to communicate with Penny Patterson or whatever, whoever is able to speak the gorilla sign language. So I saw this video and like they were like watching the movie together, and Penny Patterson asked Coco afterwards how did she feel in that certain moment, and they went for a picnic, they had a chat. So really amazing stuff. And I think it's a good example for crossing this kind of frames by having a common fundament, in this case, the technique of the language, right? So language itself, it's of course also a technique we can learn. And for that, it's also a cyborgian way of finding an interspecies communication in that case. So Donna Haraway commented this with, she said, quote, Coco 2 is a species of cyborg whose communication modalities can be translated and resynthesized to cross species and machine organism barriers. So back to body hacking. What is it about? It's exactly about breaking down this kind of like what we think it's a terminated, completed human frame where we're constantly living through. It's about breaking down, and it's not about questioning and rethinking the frame itself, but turning the frame, actually turning our bodies into a starting point where we can start as, and experiment in connection with technology to perceive and to experience our surrounding and other creatures, beings, nature in general, in a completely different way with our own experiences. So, from this also more theoretical part, I would just show you some practical body hacking projects. The first one, and I will go through some sensory modalities. I want to start with vision. So there's a, it was not long ago. It looks quite creepy actually, but this guy was inspired by snakes. That snakes that having night vision, for example, and he developed some drops that he injected into his eyes, and he got temporarily night vision and well, experienced that by himself. So the next one is hearing. So this is a project we're doing here in Berlin. And what we do, what we want to do here is hacking a cochlear implant, basically reprogramming the software of the implant in order to make here is NO, making hear ultrasonic frequencies. So remember, I told you about the bat frame. Bats communicate and orientate with echolocation, with ultrasonic waves. This will basically give him the capability to have access to these ultrasonic frequencies. And there's also one project in the US from a body hacking group in the US. They try to develop an echolocation-based orientation sense for the human. So it's not with a cochlear implant, but they experiment with implanted magnets in the ear. And well, it's really, for me personally, it's also so cool to see how the brain is so adaptive to these new technologies. If you wear it for half a year, you can completely develop this kind of new senses. So the next sense or DIY body hacking practice is haptics. This is actually a project I have done. So what I did was I went to a body modification artist here in Berlin and got a small magnet implanted here in my left ring finger. And so my basic motivation for doing that in the beginning was that I thought, okay, I just wanna, well, as I said, experiment with my perception and reflect my perception in a different way, because when I get the magnet, I can actually sense and feel electricity, for example. I can feel like live current cables in the wall or some electromagnetic waves in the public transportation or in the library. There was actually one example at my flat. So I'm living together with two flatmates, and we were not sure where to hammer the nail in the wall because we want to hang up a painting, and because there was like the socket close by, and I just like put in the what is it called, the kettle, I guess, for the boiling water, making the live current, and I could actually feel the cable in the wall. So I, well, this was a practical example where I could actually say, okay, let's hammer the nail there because there is no cable. This is for sure. So on top of that, I did also, and you already mentioned it, the body as a communication medium. I already said it. I did a hack on that. In so far that I connected my smartphone to a small amplifier, and the amplifier with an induction coil, which was around my finger here, and the induction coil sent the speaker, so to say, to the magnet. So the induction coil was, well, via induction, activating the magnet in my finger. It vibrated in my finger in the frequency of the collar, and I could actually just put my finger into my ear and hear the one who calls me through my body, through my finger. So that was a really nice experience, and that just came after like the basic motivation for me to extend my senses by putting this magnet. I realized, okay, I can hear the magnet and I can build some other projects. So it was a more like, let's say, playful approach with this kind of experiments without having any, let's say, goal or main goal to do that. So there was not this kind of like optimization, whatever thing. It was just like playing around and exploring my surrounding in a completely different way. It's not about just sensory modalities of the human. It's also about, for example, brain hacks. So this is a project from Rich Lee. He's a body hacker from the US. What he has like is basically two electrodes here on the frontal lobe. And well, the technique is called TDCS, so it's transcranial direct current stimulation. Pretty simple, actually, because you just put current on the two electrodes, and by that, a small current flows through your brain and activates some areas of your brain that, for example, optimizes the attention focus or different kind of stuff. So in the end, what we're doing at the Cyborgs e.V. is basically experimenting with these different directions these biology, technology, symbiosis are going or could go in our opinion. And we're doing that by experimenting it with our own bodies, gaining insight through that, and that we can bring into a broader societal discussion. So on one side, we're focusing on hacking our own bodies, and on the other, bring forward the discussion of human-machine integration on a societal level, let's say. So we would like to see a cyborg future where that on one hand, we break the traditional frame of what it means to be human based on our just biological skin bag and sensory apparatus. And that's very important. We want to have access to our technological cyborg parts. We want to have access to that. And that means we want to have it open source and not driven by big companies that basically have the goal of maximizing profits with our bodies. So I hope I've raised some interest by you. So we just are about to open up our own hackerspace together with an artistic collective. It's at Paul Linke Ufer 44A, so not far away from here actually. Please check out the website cyborgs.cc for further information for the regular meetings and stuff, or you can also contact me via email. Thank you.
So this way, yeah. Thanks a lot to the three of you for amazing presentations. I'm sure it created a lot of questions also in the audience. We have some time left for discussion, and I will leave it mainly to the audience, of course, to interact more with our panelists. I think I want to just really bring up one question myself, which would be directed to Jack. And so you talked about the transhumanism as something like kind of eternal state of the living dead, more or less. So somehow, or bringing back life, and we are like a, we become a zombie. Would mean become a zombie society, and there is, for example, in one of the science fiction novels that I mentioned earlier, in the story there is it's. We are at the moment where, I don't know, 2050 or something, where the consciousness is, once you die, it's being uploaded. And but the fact is that when they start to do that, the consciousness, so the these beings or the, these persons that were formerly living and then realize that they are uploaded consciousness, they get so depressed that they all commit suicide after 15 minutes at some point. And so, and there's another comment from an artist, or it was a video that went viral on the internet, Tom Scott. It's called Life Destroyed by Lawyers or something like that. And it simulates a kind of program that when you die, and then it informs you that you're now uploaded to the life network, and there are different options depending on the money in your account that you have. So what kind of option you can choose, whether it's like the primary, like full option, or like reduced options, where then parts of your memory get deinstalled because you cannot afford the thing. And there's no opt-out option also. So yeah, what I want to say, so if we become these kind of or if we go towards the society of living zombies, what apart, and if we don't want it, what apart from giving up, and what about apart from resignation, what types of resistance, forms of resistance would you see here, that in these scenarios there are not even giving up is possible anymore? So
okay,
what do you see there?
I mean, first of all, I'm not saying that if we were to realize this transhumanist dream of immortality that then we'd be a zombie society. I'm saying that under neoliberalism there's life, death, and living death. And we know that because that's why there are so many zombie films and TV shows and images around right now. We're very aware of the fact that we have produced entire classes of people as living dead. And that's a calculation that neoliberalism is willing to make. To some people it deals life, to some people it deals death, and to others as an in-between, right? So that was more, you know, where I was going with it. But you can see even in, I guess one of the things that I would want to say is that even in these fantasies, like the kind that you described, where we finally get free of the body and we become just these minds, if the social structures are the same, it won't matter whether you're just minds or whether you are still minds or bodies, because the schisms will be the same. And so there's a great film by Alex Rivera called Sleep Dealers, in which in a near future, people rent themselves out at the time that they should be asleep. They rent their minds out to a corporation that uses that mind to do business. I think what I'm trying to do relentlessly is draw us back into the social world within which these transformations have taken place or will take place, and the way in which we're imagining reworkings of the body without reworkings of the social, and without rethinking the social in the context of social justice, there's only a very destructive and scary path ahead. So in terms of, you know, resistance, I'm not in the business of offering resistance really in the way that I'm articulating this, other than to say that a different relationship to life and death has to be imagined. And so there are these artists who have imagined a different relationship to life and death.
Yeah. Thank you.
Can I make a comment?
Hi.
So you asked how to not become a technological zombie? You know, you, Daniela, you've, I mean, how about destroy all computers as an option, not give up, just what's, then we are free again, not?
I like that comment, it's a violent one. It just, for me, it just sparkles a fear of the, you know, World War II Nazi regime burning all books. I'm not sure.
Yeah, so the questions are open to the audience then, and I mean, I cannot really, so I don't know if the question was directed to me or to the panelists, to me. I don't think that pure destruction can actually really be, it has never been a strategy that actually has helped fighting problems that are, I think they are much deeper than just in the technological fact of having computers and using them. So I think that goes maybe in a bit of a different direction. So, yeah.
I would like to make another statement. I really like the fact that some kind of words are going back and forth between yesterday and today, like ubiquitous identities or zombies. And I would like to deconstruct this idea of zombie a little bit, because in the position that I've been developed today and yesterday, the idea of zombie is always negative, the zombification. And it's like the subject is completely heterodirected by an information society based on big data capitalism. For me, there is even another vision, which is like the ability to leave the zombie dimension as a queer identity. And Bruce LaBruce gave that vision with a film which is called Otto, or Up with Dead People. And by expressive, giving an idea of zombie as an open space that is not dead and is not alive. So in a way, it's like an ubiquitous identity that passes through worlds and is not closed, it's open, and always, in a way, come back on the crime scene. And this coming back on the crime scene, not letting him or her or it free, give him some kind of like a special feeling about the platform of life. And so I think that we don't have to be so strictly dialectic in between, like seeing the zombie as a subject which is completely heterodirected from an information society, but having like a little more open idea of how, what the subject can do, acquiring some kind of a post-digital network technologies to apply the cyborg as a subversive identity. It was just a statement, it was not a question.
Actually, I don't know if Jack wants to comment.
Well, just, I'm not saying that there, I'm not situating the zombie as a bad identity in relationship to good. I'm saying the zombie is a byproduct, but we're also, in many ways, always in relationship to the zombie, but in many cases we are also not the zombie. You know, the zombification is really the production of classifications of people as other whose lives can be wasted. And that's what I'm trying to get at, the fantasy that other lives are not as significant, right? And therefore these are lives that can be just used for labor, for domestic servitude, for imprisonment, and so on. But at the same time, zombies have certain opportunities. This is what I was talking about the other day. One, they are many. You know, that's why I said multitudes. They are many and they are ferocious. It's not a question of organization. It's a question of the disorganization of the zombie populations, you know, on behalf of a general distress, if you like. So it's not, we don't want to save the zombie or rescue the zombie, but recognize that the zombie is there. Yeah.
Just maybe
A couple of years ago, there was a kind of a conference festival called The Undead, The Untoten in Hamburg. This was really nice. Bruce was there with many ideas. And maybe as a second thing, just for more inspiration, like if you talked about the distinction stuff, if you want to read the most interesting new book written by a transhumanist who is at the same time very important biological researcher, it's George Church, Regenesis. And he also wants not only to resurrect the mammoth, but also the Neanderthalian, which is even a bit more frightening to some extent. And just one last point, because I was a little bit quick, I would say, like this, you said that there's this idea in the future, the minds are, that it's just a hierarchy of minds. And this is, in a way, just a reflection of what we have today, of course. And I just wanted to mention that I described not very well, because Reed was a researcher, so he was not someone fighting against them. And he was even read afterwards, because he was anti-Eurocentric. But he was at the same time in a very imperialist geographical society. And Wells had some very racist sentiments, but stopped them from the 1920s. And the other two are clearly anti-fascist. But what they have, the two communists, so there's nothing, even in eugenics, Haldane is, Bernal hates, just believe me, they're very anti-fascist, but what I find interesting is they're technocratic, and they believe so that they are still beloved in India and Africa and so on, but the idea, because they went even to these countries and so, but they believe that everyone who is not a scientific mind is to some extent the enemy, mainly the old elites and the old religions, and he was an atheist and so on. But it's all about like the bright mind rules to some extent. No matter where it comes from, the bright mind, the substrate, so to say, doesn't matter. But it's, of course, everything organized in the sense of that the brightest mind
rule.
Of course, yeah. Right. In their times, the scientific method.
Are there more questions from the audience?
Yeah, I have a question to Stefan. So you said that you have a magnet in your ring finger, and you said that you could feel the electromagnetic waves at the wall. So what kind of feeling was that? Was it a tactile feeling, or was it a totally new qualia?
No, it was a tactile feeling, of course. I don't have any new receptors developed by myself. So it's basically a tactile feeling, a vibration inside your finger.
Okay, and yeah, why? Okay, so you have kind of like opened your frame, the human frame, a little bit, and why do you think that the bat's frame is different from the human frame? When you see that when you open your frame a little bit, it stays the same qualia, the same tactile. So why do you think that there is a different bat frame at all?
Yeah, that's actually a good question, because of course the receptors that, or the technology or the artifacts speaking to me as myself, are always based on my biological receptors. So basically that stays the same. But it's more, for me personally, it was more a mind thing, that I basically reflected differently about my surrounding, right? Because once you feel that you're crossing, for example, in the library, you're crossing Diebstahlanlage, and your finger is actually vibrating, you feel, okay, there is something you haven't perceived before, and you completely start to think, okay, what else is out there, basically, right? And that's the case. What I mean, it basically breaks down this frame that I had before, that I thought like, okay, I'm constantly living through, I'm talking to you like that, and that's all right, because I don't have actually the attention resources in my brain to concentrate on all the different stuff what's going on. But having that in mind, that this is not all that exists outside of you, and there are actually ways to also, as I said with Coco, establish interspecies communication, a new understanding for nature in general is just great, and that was the basic motivation to do that.
Okay, thank you.
I'd like to just make a comment on the two last questions. I think just to the idea of what it feels like to be a bat brought me to think of shamanism and how to kind of project oneself into another type of being or slash animal, etc. And I was thinking also as zombie, like in the Haitian society, are quote-unquote slaves to a master created by someone who by the society has, and by different tools, biological tools too, has a power to put you in a state of zombie and devoid yourself of your identity, of your own self, of sense of self. Anyway, but I'm really not against brujos or brujas or shamanism. Like, I'm very interested in maybe we can enhance the concept of cyborg and zombie, like, or all the mythology of, like, cyborgs and zombies, etc. Like, and sort of, okay, let's maybe go back to witchcraft, you know? There's a lot of things to read about Donna Haraway or Beatrice Preciado. You were mentioning I can't remember the title, it's pharmaceutical. It's something Beatrice Preciado wrote before Testo Junkie, something about the. Yeah. Manifesto Contrasexual, yeah. And yeah, well, anyway, witchcraft are an important concept, I think, especially when we deal with other sensory activities.
Okay, I have a question for Stefan. I'm wondering how does biohacking movement sees the fact that our senses have developed in harmony with the environment, like for example the ear, discriminates all these higher frequencies, because if it doesn't, we just become crazy in a psychological way, hearing all these noises and everything. Like, have you thought about it? How do you see this?
I personally see that, like, if you speak about biological evolution as creating us as humans like that, I mean, basically, I think that the biological evolution is quite slow. So it's always trial and error. It goes over a million and years, and it takes a long time to adapt itself to a new environment. And I just see like a big gap what's happening right in, let's say, the technosphere and this kind of like technological movement. You talked about Moore's law, stuff like that. So this is really going very fast in a certain direction. I don't want to say if it's good or wrong, but that's a fact that's happening right now, right? And there's also a fact that we are actually very good about destroying our planet by the help of this kind of technologies. And I'm really thinking about if we could not use this kind of technologies to bring up this kind of new understandings for our environment and this kind of new understanding for also our species that live with us by the help of technology. So why not? And I don't think we can actually adapt our biological receptors that fast to actually develop this kind of understanding.
So my question is for Jack. It's a question or maybe just a reflection. I don't know. It's about the extreme reproduction that you were talking about. I totally agree with your point. I think there is some kind of insane rush for having these babies necessarily. No? But at the same time, I have a problem with it because I think we go in the question of inner choice. No? It's like life, death, abortion, the right to abortion. So like we have the right to abortion, maybe we should leave it to the person. I mean, when I talk with someone that is trying in any possible way to have this baby, and I think to myself, leave it, why you should do it, even if in the world there are so many babies already, no? But then I realize that I don't have the right to tell anything. It's a choice of that person. It's like the choice of abortion or the choice to die if you are sick. So how do you face this question, this ethic question that go back to the singular person? It's not something that we can choose altogether. How do you face this paradox, maybe?
Okay, that's a reasonable question. But I think, again, I would use that sort of zombie humanism formulation, which is that individualism has gotten us into that problem in the first place, where we can focus in only on what we need, separate from the needs of other people that we're living in relation to. There's no concept of coexistence. There's no concept of, if I use, you know, all of this money, resources, time, and technology to squeeze one piece of biological potential out of my body, what is the cost elsewhere? We're not trained to think that way. And so what masquerades as this very benevolent and liberation-oriented way of thinking about the body is actually part of the problem. It's part of the problem that we only think about, what do I want? What do I need? This is my right. This is my body. And it's not inevitable. There are other ways of thinking about bodies in relation to one another. And it may be that that's where we should be putting our energy, is to think about bodies in relation, not the body as your property in relationship to other people with their property. So I think I'm talking about a frame of mind, a way of thinking, as opposed to rights, simply.
So I would like to give a comment here. So I first of all, I thought maybe I will not be able to really take the mic and say it, but I have some problems and I need to really share it with you. So one, so if we take the word shaman, so this is a Western imposition. So in the where I come from, a shaman is called a healer or curandero. That is a completely different meaning. And I think that it's quite delicate to think the use of technology as an extension of perception. So I really think that the problems are really in a different direction, because I even ask myself, so in the project that you show with this induction coil in your finger, I ask myself, what, even the telephone is not more efficient? You know, you simply listen better with the telephone. And I ask myself, what's really the need to do something like this? So I found it a bit egocentric. So to use technology as a way to extend perception. So I mean, of course, it's valid. Everyone can do whatever they want. But what it really ring the bell to me, so was more this comment of guiding this idea of shamanism into the use of technology.
Yeah, but I think when you, I mean, it's important to mention the healer part, but I think in therapeutics, I think it's important to explore other ways for yourself in order to be able to heal other people. And yeah, I think just because I brought the term shaman, but not like knowing also that the healing part is important, but in order to be able to heal, to have you have also to explore, you know, a ritual of initiation, etc. That, yeah.
Okay. Let's maybe, because we are already a little bit over time, to not go too much over time, let's make take maybe one or maximum two questions, and then we have to finish. There in the back were some more, and there there's one on the side.
Can I?
I don't know.
Hello?
Or just, yeah.
We I just have an ethical, moral question. I saw a YouTube video of some, I guess you can call it biohacking, someone growing a rat's brain in a petri dish, and that rat's brain was controlling a little a cart, an electrical cart, which was driving, and it was able to realize where the walls are and was avoiding the walls. So that let me think, like, holy shit, like, maybe this is the way how artificial intelligence will be done, by just growing through stem cells or the fiber of a human brain, and then letting that control whatever, right? It could be hanging in the internet and playing whatever. So what is the moral and ethical limits to these kind of things? It's my question. Whoever wants to answer, please go ahead.
So then let's collect the last two questions, and then one on the side, and then maybe we can...
They are there. Very long.
Yeah. Can you please pass on the microphone?
I have the mic. I've got two hopefully quick questions. First for Stefan. When you were doing with the senses, so sound, hearing, sight, touch, and so on, are you working, or is anyone working with, say, pain receptors or acceleration receptors or proprioception, or is there an interest in this, or is it more just sort of reduced down to the sort of the standard senses that everyone can, you know, like conceptualize? Is anyone working with other senses, or is this completely... That was my question.
Maybe you can answer the last questions that were more or less all directed to you, or at least in part, and then we take one more question in general.
So, but if you want, you can make the moral ethics part, and I can do the same, talk about this one, because actually, I think both of you showed Stellark as an artist, and he experimented a lot with kinesthetic sense, and more like this kind of like more movement-based stuff and so on. If I understood you right, like pain receptors or acceleration? I think Moon Rebus, for example, she's together with Neil Harbison, and she did some, like, she had, for example, a sensor attached to her head that recognized movements on the outside, but it was also more conceptual. Based on that, she made a dancing performance, for example. But pain receptors or stuff like that, I don't know.
Okay, the ethics part, maybe. So I would say all the biological, or very simply said, all the biological part of any kind of cyborg identities, if it is cannot consent to something, I would suggest it's immoral. And I would also say I find it very problematic, not also in this discussion, but also concerning Ritalin and all this stuff. I would say the right of the child is more important than the opinions of the parents. Whenever you can delay a decision, wait until the child is grown up. There are differences, like, for example, in case of cochlear implants, it's very good if you take the decision early, then it's problematic. But in general, children have also rights, and parents should, in these kinds, where it's about physical integrity, should not be decide if it's not necessary. can delay it. And finally, if you think about all the animals, I leave out animals, other animals, so to say, at this moment, but if it comes to all kinds of biological material, then we of course have all the question concerning how is this produced, to what cost, what else could be done with the same resources, for what purposes is it used, is it for making, say, a senior person in the rich countries having a body like a 20-year-old, is this so important? As long as we, even in our rich areas, in many cities, we cannot go with a wheelchair wherever we want or so, or with a stroller or so. I think these are, from my point of view, the most important ethical or societal aspects, I would call them.
Yeah, and maybe just a comment. Hello? Yeah. because I think it's one thing to develop the ethical framework in general, like on a broader scale and legally, and then to for the whole society to somehow establish rules that work, that are developed in time with the progress. And the other thing is to maybe compare this already with practices that are being in use already now. So I think what I would be interesting to hear in general in the cyborgs, if you have any kind of developed any kind of rules or a manifesto, if you want to say, or where you say, okay, here are the limits until where we want to explore, and then maybe even if it's egoistically, but we want to try out with our own bodies, but we say here's the limit, and so I don't know, maybe you can tell something.
We actually wrote a manifesto, but it's not finished yet, but it's already online, so if you want to, you can check that out at wiki.cyborgs.cc. But talking about the limits and the moral or ethical implications of body hacking, first, for me it's difficult to speak for Cyborgs if all, because there are different opinions on that, actually. But my personal point of view is that the integration of technology basically into the human body, this is basically the different, I would say, the main difference than before, because we use technology or we use tools since the beginning of humanity. I mean, this is a basic thing of humans to integrate non-biological constructs, being able to make this integration of tools. So we have done that forever. That's nothing new. It's just a part that I think is the crossing the line of the skin and getting the technology inside the body and making it invisible, and thus kind of like having the feeling of losing control, right? So these are like very, I think, deep fears that have existed also, not just yet, but before. And so far, I think it's a natural thing. What means natural? I mean, it's a continuous line of evolution, let's say, where our tools, our technology got closer to us as humans, and there's In that sense, no limits or no limitations that we should bear in mind until here and not more. So I don't see this limitation at all. And this basically goes to a transhumanist vision in the end. Basically, this is just the end vision of that. But I think it's much more interesting to see how we actually, as individuums, as biological individuums, get a more collective part that is technological, and how we handle that, how we, for example, define privacy in future, stuff like that, right? Because we're fluently connected with this technological part that me as an individuum has access, but also other people have access to me, to myself. So this is, I think, a social contract thing that we have to develop as a society, and with that, bringing up new norms and new standards, what we see as a human being. And right now it's more like this anthropocentric view of the human. So this is my body, this is my capability as a human, whatever. But I think this will dramatically change in future by having this collective technological part of the human.
Okay, thank you very much. I think unfortunately we're definitely now out of time. So I will say thank you again very much for your presentations, for your time, for answering the questions.